lost you there. Do you like the dramatic lighting from the side, like just one light, or do you like kind of the bigger fill light? Which one? This is more dramatic and like cinematic. This is more, hello. Oh yeah, happy Thursday to you. We'll keep this short and simple, but good morning. I hope you are doing well. Thank you so much for being here. We hit 1,000 subscribers yesterday, and I say we because this will always be about us and this team and this just this group of people communicating and learning together and growing together and going through this journey together. So thank you so much for being here. Let's get to work. So I'm just exporting a final feature film right now, and then I'll upload it on my site, Mediazilla, that I use, and then I will send it to the client, which is so exciting. I love sending like finished things to clients and couples because it's just like another huge like checklist of another project completed, which is awesome. I try to at least knock out minimum of one film or two films for couples a week because obviously each week I'm adding a new one to it, so the last thing I want is to be way backlogged on the edits, so it's really exciting. So that's what I'm doing right now, is exporting that and sending to them. But it brings up another topic that's actually extremely important, and I actually talked about this in yesterday's vlog, but then I ended up not putting any of it inside the vlog because there was just already too much stuff that I talked about in that episode. So I decided to kind of leave it more to today, and that is the idea of knowing your demographic when you are editing and when you are filming a project. And here's what I mean by that. One thing that I always do every single time I get done exporting or finishing what I think is a finished feature film specifically for a wedding, I always bring it to my wife and I let her see it first before I ever send it off. Now, there are a couple main reasons behind that. You see, I don't bring any of my actual commercial work to her to ask for approval. I don't bring vlogs to her to ask what she thinks first, but I do bring weddings to her, and specifically because she is my target demographic. You see, 95% of people who contact me about a wedding film are females, primarily the bride, and they are the ones that are my target demographic of ones that I need to grab the emotion for to make them book me for future weddings. And because she is the target demographic, she is the person that I am trying to go after to get to love films, it's very important for me to let her see them and see what she reacts to see whether it draws emotion, even though she doesn't know the couple, to see whether she instantly picks something out and says, whoa, that was weird, or that edit was weird, or I think that. It's very important for me to know what she thinks about it because that's who watches these films the most. You see, the grooms, they obviously care about the wedding films because they're also part of the wedding day, but at the same time, they are more interested in whether or not their fiance or now wife loves the films, because that's ultimately the most important, which is a great strategy, man. But I'm always amazed when I'm a part of these different wedding filmmaking websites and Facebook groups and all these different things about the amount of people that will post their wedding films and ask people what they think of them, and then they'll take critiques based on what other wedding filmmakers talked about and what they should improve and blah, 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 blah. And it kind of just is interesting to me of why people care so much. You see, if I'm being completely honest, I could care less what another wedding filmmaker, another wedding company, what another client, what another YouTuber, I could care less what they think about my wedding film, specifically because A, they're not the ones that paid me, and B, they're not the ones that I'm trying to get work from. If I post on a Facebook group, here's what my wedding film looks like, would love to know your thoughts, and someone tells me that they didn't like the way this drone shot was colored, or they didn't like the way this audio did this, or this did this, or that cut looked weird there, and I change it, I'm basically changing it to make the other filmmaker like the film more, when that's not the person who actually paid me, nor do I need to care what they think. Now, it doesn't mean you shouldn't take constructive criticism from somebody if you're new to the game and you want to know what people think, and then that's all great and there's nothing wrong with that. But most importantly, I need two people to be extremely happy when I deliver a film. That is the bride and the groom. And if I am achieving that, and if every single film that I am delivering is getting exactly that reaction, and right now, as I speak, I have 100% 5-star success rate on every film that I've ever done. And that is, I think, because my target demographic, females, and specifically the grooms as well, well, the couples are who I'm really, really, really trying to make the happiest in that. You see, I don't really care if you watching this like my wedding film, you don't like the color grade, or you don't like this shot, or you think I should have shot. Ultimately, I don't care. And I mean that in a nice way. I mean that in a way like you're not the person that I'm trying to impress. And I think if as a filmmaker and as a company, I always approach everything with who is my target demographic in this, I will be and continue to be successful in the things I do. And a great example as well is I'm currently working with a healthcare company that wants to create videos for a demographic that is an older demographic. They're trying to go after a demographic that is over 60 years old. Now, it would be stupid of me to create videos and talk about how I really think it's important to do quick cuts and attention grabbing this and attention grabbing this and energetic music to create a video for a demographic that I don't really know about. You see, what I would do is I go after and I go to 60-year-olds and over 60-year-olds and I ask them some advice. I ask them for what kind of things that they look for, what grabs their attention. And if I was also doing a complete social media marketing campaign for 13 to 19, 20-year-olds, well, you see, I would go after as many 13 to 20-year-olds and ask them how they consume media. Because you see, if I know my target demographic and I know exactly how that demographic sees things and cares about things, I will make a better product, which will ultimately get a return to the company, which will ultimately get me more work. If the only thing I care about is making it look cinematic and making the LUT look how I want and making it be as jumpy and energetic as possible, but yet that's not at all what's catering to the demographic that it's actually at, well, I'm not gonna get more work because of that. So a huge tip I can give you is that if you're new to this filmmaking thing, or if you're new to just filmmaking in general, or you're starting your own video production company, or you currently have one, is to really know your demographic. Every single time I meet with a client, the very first thing I say is, you know, what video are you looking to create? And more importantly, who are you trying to reach with this video? Because once I know who you're trying to reach, then I know how we can reach them effectively. And then I go to work at creating a video that meets those two things. If that makes sense, and if it doesn't, that's probably why you're not getting a lot of work. I really wanted to run to Starbucks today and edit just because I really haven't had that passion tea in a while and I really, really want it, but I have a package coming today that I have to get. I accidentally shipped out those lenses before I got the other ones because the other ones were supposed to be here yesterday, and then the delay shipment is now not supposed to come till today, and I have a wedding tomorrow, so I'm really, really, really hoping it actually comes today, or else tomorrow's wedding will be very interesting. Today's pro tip is definitely do not ship out a lens before you get the other lens that you were replacing it with, which I already know, but I just wasn't thinking.
Oh yeah.
Lunch is served. All right, well, I finally finished this whole project and this whole film package for this couple. It was by far the largest, like, analyst and render files I've ever seen. I don't know what it was about this project. We used a lot of optical flow. The editor that I work with, he likes to slow things down in certain segments, and we don't always shoot things with the intention of slowing down, so we sometimes use what's called optical flow, which, if you're familiar with Final Cut, it's a way that they kind of create extra frames to make 24 frames footage slow down. But anyway, the files are massive, and it was probably the largest file like library I've ever done. The wedding file, just the file for the wedding in Final Cut, was 876 gigs or something insane, which is absurd. So now that it's finally done, I can delete all the render files and delete all the analyst files, but my goodness, I was waiting around a lot today trying to get that done.
Oh yeah, knock another one out.
I admit I was getting a little worried that this wasn't gonna come. I was gonna end up trying to figure out how I was gonna shoot an entire wedding with like two lenses, but it came. I'm really excited about these lenses. So I returned and got rid of those 12 to 100 Olympus lenses. I thought they were good lenses, but they had a greenish tint, which I really did not like. It was really odd actually. It had this just severe green tint. And it also was an F4, so I just wasn't crazy about that either. So I actually just ended up going with the Panasonic 35 to 100 F2.8. So these are essentially 70 to 200 equivalents. And I got these for two reasons. Number one, it's super important that I have an F2.8. But more importantly, what is incredible about these 70 to 200s, insanely small. Now, anyone that knows how big a 70 to 200 typically is, this is unbelievable. The best part about it is that it doesn't even come out. That is the full size all the time. So a 70 to 200 in this size is absurd. So this is just that 70. I can't even literally probably show you what 200 looks like because it'd be insanely tight, but that's a good looking lens. And the reason I got two is the same reason I always get two 70 to 200s, which is that I primarily use these only at the ceremony and for some interview stuff, but I like to have one on the bride side, one on the groom side, so I can have the proper tightness, the same tightness on both sides. So I'm really, really excited about these lenses. And my goodness, they are so small. Pro tip, get a label maker and put labels on the top of the caps. Then it makes it super easy to just look in the case and know what lens it is. 70-200.
Oh, it's tiny.
And look it.
Does it move up?
No, how amazing is that? So I am just going over all the details for tomorrow's wedding, so Friday wedding rather than Saturday, which is going to feel weird because Saturday is going to feel like Friday, and then church is, it's going to feel weird. I'm going to be all thrown off. But anyway, that's going to be it for the vlog. I've been talking a lot in the vlog, which I know to some people is not super exciting, but been really, really fired up. I think the content has been really good and hopefully helpful to you. And so I hope that that is valuable to you. Tomorrow is another big day, another long wedding. It's going to be great. Thanks for watching. I will see you tomorrow. Thanks for watching.